to pivot to see you all. It's a little bit odd, so you'll have to excuse me if I'm not making good eye contact. Well, welcome this morning to your session on assessment. Were you excited to come today? People, they think of it like a session on taxes, right? Or the budget, or something like that, or something that we just have to do, but we really wish we didn't have to do it. And that's really kind of a shame. I think it's natural, though, as we think about assessment, I always think about how it fits into our workload. I would bet that there's not a person out there who wouldn't say that his or her workload is extremely full right now. Is that correct? Unless somebody would like to say, no, actually, I've got plenty of time on my hands. There you go. So when I always think of a spectrum on my workload of, you know, 1 to 10, 10 being the things that make me really excited to do my job, things, the reason I do it, they fire me up, and 1 being the stuff I just have to get done. So on my scale, the stuff I love to do are talking to people about all the work you do and watching students succeed. That's like way up at the top. And way at the bottom is paperwork. I hate paperwork. But I do it, right? Because it's part of the entire thing. So let's do that for all of you. Spectrum. Things that get you really excited. Things you just have to do. Where is, and this is not a quiz, so, you know, there's no wrong answer, as you know. Where is the act of teaching? Where is it? Oh, face-to-face, online, whatever turns you on. The act of teaching. Where does that go? It's up there, right? Hi. Is it high? I hope it's high, right? There are faculty in this room, right? Hi, it's up there, isn't it? Isn't that the reason you do what you do? That's good. Whew. Thought we had a big problem, Brady. Really glad our faculty like to teach. So what about the act of, or the process of watching students learn? Where's that? 1 to 10? 10, right? That's pretty exciting to see the light go off in their eyes or a really cool post online. I mean, that's kind of what motivates us, right? How about some committee work? Where's that fall? -1. Oh, we're in a negative scale like we are outside in the temperature. -25. Now, I would bet some of you disagree with that extreme. But it falls somewhere less than 9 or 10, let's say. There are some people who love committee work. What about assessment? Where does it fall? 5's pretty good. Oh, wait. We have had a revelation at 8:30 in the morning. Mark says 5, and then said, but I'm thinking about assessment in a different way. My ability to check students' knowledge. Mark, why is that a different way from assessment? Okay, so this act of checking students' knowledge and getting immediate feedback is kind of assessment, and in your mind, you take it's separate from assessment. It's not, is it? So for most of us, I'm just picking on Mark. I did not put him there. I did not pay him to say those things. For many of us, I've lost, so not only have we had a revelation, none of our faculty like to teach, but I've lost the audience in 5 minutes. Go ahead, Mark, what do you got? It all comes back to budget. It's just the way it is. Okay, So here's the thing, you all love to teach, you all love students learning, we know that. And then there's this thing that's assessment at the bottom. And really, most of us think of assessment as my paperwork, this thing I just have to do. I just have to get it done. But what Mark said is right. That is not assessment. It has become assessment in our country and in both secondary and post-secondary. It's become a bit of a bad word, a drain on our energy, something that has very little value when the word pops up. But it need not be that way. What Mark described, you know, assessing whether my students are learning things, is not even a sort of assessment. It is assessment. So if we're doing assessment right, it should be really, really easy. And all of you are experts at it. So I absolutely know something. What do I know? I absolutely know. Is Sarah here? Sarah Kath? I was going to pick on Sarah. All right. Well, if Sarah were here, and I said to her, ran into her in the elevator, anybody, and said, hey, you teach that communication thing, right? So I've heard you talk a lot about critical thinking. How do you know your students can think critically? She wouldn't even have to think about it. She'd say, because critical thinking is blank, 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 and this is what I teach my students to do, and I know they can do it because in this assignment, they do it. So they can think critically, period. That's assessment. I know that if I ask Sandra, do your students know anything about communicable diseases? Do they, Sandra? A little bit. They know just a little bit about those. She could quickly say why, because she had the goal of teaching them the following. This is how she teaches them. And she then does something, talks to them, tests them, and stay on their head and spit jelly beans about staphylococcus. I don't know what she does, but she assesses their knowledge. That's assessment. It need not be fancy. It need not be complicated, but it does need to be valuable to you. The other part of assessment that is critical is whether you use it, right? So what if I were talking to Paul? And I said, Paul, we're in the elevator talking about MACE. I said, Paul, have you made any changes to your courses in the past few years? Any at all, Paul? You have, well, good. I'm glad to hear that. Please don't tell me if you're not making any changes to your courses. I've already had enough revelation for the day. And if Paul, we had the elevator at least went up to the 14th floor, and I said, well, give me an example. I'm sure Paul has made some kind of change because he realized his students were struggling with some concept that he previously deemed to be important and attempted to teach them. Right? That's assessment and continuous improvement. It is easy. It is what you need to know, and it should be the most valuable part of what we do. So if we assess right at Central Lakes College, when you look at that spectrum, assessment should be right up there with teaching and with student learning because it really is one and the same. It is. And I ask you today, as you sit down and come up with your plans, and I know that you'll be doing that because I see that you've got work to do on your tables and you're in your departments and you've come up with some wonderful things. I ask you to ask yourself one question. Is what I'm writing down valuable to me as a faculty member? If the answer is no, how about we not do it? If it's not valuable, why do you want to waste your time on it? No one's going to tell you, you must. You have to put something down. I mean, you can't say I'm not doing that, because saying I'm not doing that means I don't care about student learning and I'm never changing anything in my courses. Paul, he's not going to ever say that. But if you write down only those things that you want to know, that you know in your hearts that you're trying to get your students to learn, you know how you're going to try to get them to learn, then you're going to assess whether or not they did, and you're going to make a change, that's all it needs to be. So I ask you to make sure that assessment is valuable. That's the most important thing. And it has to be driven by faculty. I want to thank Brandy and the Student Learning Assessment Committee, understand, is affectionately known as
Slack.
Now, so thank you. I think you should give them all a round of applause. Because there does have to be a bit of an organizational structure to this whole thing. And they really have done some heavy lifting. But it is you, the faculty, who determine whether CLC does a good job assessing student learning. And then once we know that you are, and I know that you are, sometimes it's just about capturing it on paper, getting it written down. What changes did you make and why? What do you want your students to learn? How do you know? Once we get those things down on paper, we hope the next step is that people read what you've written and they learn from where our weaknesses are at the college. I hope that as we look at your assessment reports, as your deans will look at them, Doug will look at them, I'll look at them, and we'll determine if there are changes that we have to make at the college based on what you've learned in your classes. Because our goal is to make sure that you have what you need to help students learn. So let's commit to making assessment valuable to each and every one of you, and let's commit to not doing anything that's an absolute waste of time. With one exception, I do plan to make brown snow today. That is probably, right, Mark, a complete waste of time, but I'm gonna do that today. But for the rest of the day, can we please commit to not doing anything that's a waste of time? Make it valuable. And I would suggest that maybe we not call it assessment anymore. Call it something else. It's a horrible word. It's a terrible word. It means nothing good. It doesn't matter what you call it. Give it another name, something that makes you smile. Because it's important for what you do each and every day. And we appreciate what you do. Thank you. I think that's it. I have nothing.
Thank you so much to President Charlier for introducing our session today. And it's so nice to be first on the agenda today, too, when you're fresh, right? Great. Thank you, too, for all of those who did update their assessment plans in December. You know, the whole point of that mid-semester deadline was just to get us paying attention to our assessment, see if we are embedding and integrating it into what we're doing as teachers and making it easy for us and documenting that as needed. So if you have any questions about your assessment plans and reports that we updated in December, please be in touch. If you aren't sitting in departments now, you can move there in a little bit. We're going to just go over a few things. I don't have a lot of slides. I won't bore you too much, but I just want to give a little overview. And really, the idea today is to think ahead to April 7th, because just like this day came so quickly, and the fall semester went by so quickly, April 7th will come very quickly. This is a day that has been granted to us to work on assessment. We've been told it's a priority. I am currently working on the assurance argument that President Charlier mentioned yesterday to make an argument that we are meeting that criteria. And your work really helps me to make that argument persuasively, effectively. So I'm working on that argument. And one of the things we argued that we needed was time. And that's what April 7th is for. So we just want to be thoughtful in how we approach that day. And so I have a very simple work plan that I'm asking you to go over with your department today. Just check off a few boxes. I'm also asking for a little feedback on that form. And then leave it behind. I'm going to pick them up, review them, and then I will put them back in one of your mailboxes so that you get that work plan back in case that is useful to you, that information, which it hopefully will be. So in a little bit, we'll get to that. You'll have, about 15 minutes. Our session goes till 9:30, so I plan on at least giving you the last 15 minutes of the session, if not a little more, toward just discussing with your department, giving you a little time to touch base, since that's something we need, preparing and creating a simple work plan for assessment day. But just a few thoughts first. And if you haven't sat in your departments now, you can move there a little bit later. I really was intentional about calling this your assessment program because as we segue into, different, and my vision is to have rotating assessment leadership with faculty in the future, and that's what I'm recommending as we move into the future. And as I approach a hopeful sabbatical in 2018-19, I'm recommending we have a rotation system for assessment leadership and that it's a shared role with a career and technical liberal arts faculty with a simple task list annually. So I'm really recommending that, and I think a lot of us will have a chance to steer assessment, keep it going over the following years. So it is our program, as President Charlier indicated, this is faculty-driven, should be faculty-driven, and we want to continue to own that and call it ours. This is a quote from a book that came out recently. Somehow this is not very good. Oh, I can move. No, I can't, Mike. Okay. The fact that conversations about higher education assessment are difficult, as President Charlier indicated, we often have these feelings about it, is because it's fraught with difficulties and skepticism and such, it's more important for higher education faculty to contribute and lead the way. And I agree on this. If we step back and say, we don't get it, it's too complex, we don't really buy into it, that to me, that could be dangerous. I think we should be front and center in defining this work that is so integral to what we do as educators. This is some comment that I thought I would share from way back in 2002 and then 2006. We had a monitoring report where we were, as they say, dinged for assessment because we weren't doing it well. And this was a simple feedback that we got from a couple of our reviewers. They said, an effective assessment program must include the definition of measurable course and program objectives. I have that in green because we've got that now. The measurement of student learning in relation to those objectives and the analysis of resulting data. I have it in yellow because we could improve in that area, but we have made a lot of headway there. We are gathering data. We are trying to analyze it and use it. That last part, though, in red is something we probably struggle with most, which is course program improvement based on that learning data. Are we really following through with what we're seeing with the assessment data? That's harder to follow through with, that's harder to document. But that's where we're trying to grow and move forward with. This is a rubric, to use assessment lingo, that's used by the National Institute of Learning Outcomes Assessment, which is an organization helping higher ed leaders like myself wrap our heads around this subject, saying here's the criteria for having a strong assessment program. On this infograph here, we are meeting, I think, most of these criteria. I have an arrow pointing to the one I think we need the most work in, which is use of student learning evidence. This is the part that is the reason we do it to begin with. Do we really use it? Do we really use the data as individual instructors, as programs departments, and as a college? So this is where we need to continue to refine and pay attention to our assessment work. Just some data that I can't remember if I shared earlier, and this is pretty recent. There might be a couple changes to this data, but as far as submitting reports last year, this was the data. We had pretty good participation as these things go, and this doesn't really say anything about quality of reporting or information, but it just says we are trying to engage. We are trying to participate in assessment. We do have fairly broad faculty participation and engagement, which is a huge thing that HLC looks for. It's one of their, they have a short list of criteria for assessment, and one of them is, are faculty engaged? And I think we can continue to improve in this area. These are just a few examples of things you brought up in your reports last year. I just have four examples. And I wanted to bring this back to what President Charlier said. I am grateful that she brings up that this really is about what we do anyway, what we care about anyway. And so these simple observations that occur through the study of student learning, which is what we care about anyway, is assessment. And we're just documenting it. I think what gets in the way is the form and the deadlines. And sometimes I think we should radically just somehow have a program that just, there's no deadlines and no forms. And then maybe we just all get together and analyze student data and act, and maybe just never have to fill out a form. Maybe that would somehow get people over the hump. The form and having to document, I know it gets in the way for a lot of people of what this work really is, which I think is very natural and integral to who we are as instructors. But biology said in the blue they were going to possibly, based on their assessment learning data, add a math prerequisite to these courses or additional pre-lab practice for story problems and techniques. They also said we could better invest time developing student skills in data analysis. And now, it's hard to tell from this report if that happened, was there follow-through, and that's why there is a place on the 2016-17 report to follow through on some of that. Like, did this actually occur? Did this actually happen? In another program, Horticulture said, we will develop a universal safety training assessment rubric. That's great. That's what this assessment work indicates. Maybe we need more work in this area. Maybe we need a rubric to help us understand this area of student learning better, and this is assessment. And hopefully it ties into your curriculum and instructional design naturally. It shouldn't be an extra, an addendum. It is what we do and what we might do anyway. Next year, I will spend more time and attention on demonstrating proper seed and seedling care. I will spend more in-class time on watering and fertilizing rather than homework as homework so that I can observe. These simple things that we might change based on a study of student learning are our assessment and are meaningful to us, I hope. Art said that, I liked this one that Casey found, that students thought they ranked themselves higher than he did or the instructor did on their like mastery of craft. And he had some data to prove that. 15 ranked themselves, or 12 ranked themselves higher than the instructor had. I thought that was really interesting. And to me, this is where assessment data is interesting. Oh, wow, 12 of them thought they were superior. They were pretty quite masterful in the craft of art making. And Casey didn't have the same perception. So he talked about he could improve students' understanding of a high level of craftsmanship. What is that? What is high level of craftsmanship? He could provide more examples, comparisons, introduce visual examples of quality craftsmanship, maybe make that a more transparent conversation in the classroom so they rate themselves lower next time, right? That's the goal. Graphic design, this is the last example I'll offer today. By the way, these are the kinds of narratives and that I'm going to be showing HLC. Yep, we do assessment, our faculty document, use it, act on it, and these are the kinds of things that are meaningful. He talks about starting sooner, Leon, at fine-tuning project portfolios because there are some time issues. Discuss layouts and mock-ups. better and use more process thinking pieces in the portfolio. I love the specific language that's coming out of these examples, which is why I chose a lot of them. I always tell them, as a writing teacher, I'm always saying, please be a little more concrete, more specific, because then it's more persuasive, more meaningful. And these examples have that specificity. NAPTI test results show that we need to spend more time in multimedia technology. It was nice to hear that those technical skills assessments showed this instructor something, showed Leon something, and now he can add more content assignments for typography and color theory there. A couple of thoughts on what we need, and I just have a few more slides here at CLC as I'm thinking ahead and planning forward and trying to continue improve our program and sustain it. I think we need, again, continued faculty leadership and engagement. This is a constant struggle. You know, just when I think I've got people, I hear from somebody, we don't care about it, you know, and it's a constant struggle to try to say, no, we do care about it, let's keep on board and make this feasible and usable and meaningful for us. But it's a constant challenge to do that. We need a sustainable cycle of assessment data gathering. It has to be something that we can fit into our workloads, but we need to be consistent. We need to sustain that cycle. Get the data, look at the data, act on the data. It's a simple cycle. We just need to sustain it and weave it into our work. And we need to constantly assess our assessment program as well. I think annually or every other year we should sit down and say, is this working? What tweaks should we make to our assessment program to make it work better for faculty, for the college? Some other recommendations I have moving into, especially thinking ahead, maybe into 2018-19 and into next year. As I mentioned, I'm recommending that in the future we have a career tech and a liberal arts kind of assessment co-chairs on sort of a data team. I don't like that name, but some sort of team that continues to drive this work, but with a very clear task list. So it's not an unmanageable workload, something that, you know, I do this and you do this, and we have a two-year rotation for this. We have a two-year rotation. We have a sustainable cycle that's already in place that we can just continue to follow and build. A lot of the foundation is there. We can just continue to grow it. I am also recommending that we continue to ground assessment at the program or department level. I think that is where we get engaged. And I do, however, think that we could explore transitioning liberal arts to a broader assessment goal of maybe looking at general ed at the Minnesota Transfer Curriculum. Because we have so many tiny departments on the liberal arts side and the career tech side, it might behoove us to work together to do some assessment, but that should be faculty driven and should be decided by faculty that we want to move in that direction. But that's just an idea I had to maybe make the work more meaningful on the AN liberal arts degree part of the college. On the career tech side, I think it could be interesting if down the line, like let's say career tech, and this is just a suggestion, all looks at something like career readiness or soft skills together, because I hear from a lot of career tech people that that's an issue. What if you could do a simple assessment that was embedded into your curriculum that would gather some interesting data and help you to improve student learning in that area, preparing them in career readiness or soft skills in some way? So just some thoughts on how we could continue to make our program more robust, but we should always be guarded, make sure we keep it feasible so it can be sustainable, so we can keep going, and so we don't have stops and starts. This is a cycle, just a visual of something that coincides with my kind of plan and recommendations that I would like to become more apparent to folks, this idea of a clear cycle. And once we have maybe, if there are co-chairs and like a data team that continue to drive this work, I have to sort of, you know, cycle through the semesters, spring, fall and spring, to say here's what we would be doing during that time, what leads up to assessment day. And I won't read all of those, but I'll put this PowerPoint on the D2L, Student Learning Assessment site, so if you want to review it later, look at it later, and I'll try to make this visual more available to you. This is one of my favorite assessment pictures from last year. You've maybe seen this before, but I had to bring this up just because there's so much joy, believe it or not, that does come in my role because I do get to know people. Like, I know so many faculty members at this college, even if it started out with a rougher conversation about assessment, I've gotten to know so many of you and had so many good conversations. But the reality is when you're the assessment chair, you cause assessment angst in people when they see you. And I know that when you see me in the hallway or cafeteria, because I know, because I've had many, many, many encounters. Just yesterday, I had at least 3 to 5. At the Christmas party, I had 3 to 5. You know, people have to bring it up, you know, the assessment thing. I can't wait, in a way, as much as I enjoy this role, for a time when you ask me, somebody asked me a grammar question last October, I think it was Tracy, and I was like, thank you! You know, like, yes, I'm an English teacher, remember that. But anyway, so, because your assessment guilt and angst surface when you see me, I thought I would offer a few suggestions today. And that is 10 ways to survive unexpected encounters with your student learning assessment chair. Number one, duck into the men's bathroom with a wink and a friendly finger point as if to say, I mean well, but I haven't measured student learning since 2002. She probably won't follow you in there. Bury your face in that Mad Hubbard cheeseburger. You're obviously famished and have had no energy to conduct rigorous data analysis. Number three, flatter as a distraction tactic. I love your glasses, but don't leave time for a return compliment. She'll just criticize the lack of detail in column three and question eight of your assessment report. Four, take that alternative stairwell for a disappearing act while she adjusts her bifocals, but do it quickly because she walks fast and may follow to ask for your delinquent learner data. Number five, play befuddled. With googly eyes and a shrug, compare navigating SharePoint to Hugh Glass journeying through the South Dakota wilderness. That SharePoint's a grizzly. Rubbing it there. I haven't even seen the movie. Take that, come clean, because you're an honest soul. Confess, I haven't done what you asked. Then, ask her to repeat all of her previous directions, but in 100 words or less, you've got places to be. That Christmas clearance at Risky Business moves fast. Sorry. Number eight, resist. Look down at the floor and walk on by with a subtle grunt. You're a rebel. She can respect that. Number nine, divulge. Heck, these are transparent times. Overshare all about your program's dwindling resources. If that doesn't work, just blame it on your problem colleague who, quote, was supposed to get that stuff in, or blame your dean, your dog, or Bruce Eastman. Number 10, grab your phone and text fiercely. It's obviously an important matter. Or better yet, just thump your fingers madly along the sides of your head while talking to the gigantic cactus. Your assessment chair will know to leave you be. Okay. In all seriousness, I do, as I said, I have enjoyed getting to know you, and I am empathetic. I know all those cringes and reactions that I get. I know where they're coming from. I've been in your shoes. But I encourage you to just not worry so much when you approach me in the hallway. Ask me a grammar question. I'll see if I can answer it. This closing thought, and then we'll move here into creating a simple work plan for assessment day. Faculty members and institutional leaders need to engage in assessment primarily for purposes of improving their own teaching and learning. If they get that right, success with actors like regional accreditors will automatically follow. I'm so grateful to hear that our president agrees with us that we should drive assessment, that this should be meaningful to us, our instruction, and if we do that, if we make it meaningful for us, that does meet HLC standards. Rather than think, what do they want? Let's just try to give them what they want. Let's make it meaningful for us and make an argument that we have a decent and even effective assessment program. And that's my goal for us. Let's get back to this for a minute. Honestly, encountering and getting to know you all is a great privilege in this role, as I've said. When my students avoid writing, like we avoid our assessments sometimes, and getting engaged in the writing process, they find the concept of writing tedious, meaningless, and baffling. I don't understand the assignment, Brandy. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to get started. But when they stop mulling over the concept and actually just write for themselves and with investment, they almost always experience growth and purpose. They become writers with intention. And I ask you to challenge your own feelings or perceptions of assessment. Simply do the work, but not the work of completing an assessment form, just the work of studying your student learning, changing it, owning it, making it meaningful for you, changing instruction, curriculum in some way in an attempt to improve student learning. I want to remind us that we can keep it simple. And these basic questions drive assessment. What information do you use to modify? That's what really goes in that document. What do you use to modify? Don't tell us everything. Highlight a couple things that you use that are really important to your program or department. And secondly, what changes have you made based on looking at your student learning information that's integrated into your curriculum? These are the two components. If you just think of that, measure meaningfully and then analyze it and act, that's all assessment is, and documenting that in a simple, clear way in your report is all we ask, so that we can share that information and understand what you're working on. The assessment day that's coming up, April 7th, is a Friday. I remind you to check your syllabi to make sure you indicated to that students that that is not a day of class. We have that is specifically designed not as just a loose duty day, but a duty day for assessment work. And I think it's good, as I said earlier, to think ahead toward that day. For sure, we will have self-guided work time. And the time that we'll have, the amount of time, is still up for debate, I guess. And that's why on the form that's on your table, and I'm asking just each department to fill out one form, not each person. So just as a department, fill out one form and indicate how many hours you think your department would like to have that day for self-guided assessment work. Then below that, there's some things you'll be filling out as well. Other possible agenda items for April 7th include the following. I know we had a speaker last year, and that went over pretty well. I've gotten some mixed thoughts on should we or should we not have that. For a variety of reasons, we may not have a speaker this year because we may need some, as we're preparing this assurance argument for HLC, we may need that time to do some other things. But I did ask for your feedback on that form, so you as a department can tell me what would you most value other than the work time, what kind of a session would you enjoy having or like to see offered on April 7th. So it could be a cross-discipline peer review where we look at each other's work and evaluate in a friendly, collegial way and have some good conversations. We could have a college-wide discussion of some of the things we're finding and see if we can locate some patterns and needs. We could have a workshop on how to streamline our program outcomes or assessment process. We could have a workshop on indirect measures, how to design an indirect measure. We could have a speaker, possibly, too. So I'm asking you for your feedback, and I'll continue to work on this agenda early this semester and gradually share that with you. Here's the work plan that you have in front of you. I'm asking you now, in a couple minutes, we have this session until 9:30, so you have plenty of time to find your people, and as a department, fill out this simple work plan. I didn't even ask for any actual sentences on this work plan. Just all about checking boxes. Maybe I'm just pandering to you too much. I don't know. Make it too easy. But if you do, I want to say, if you do have a good idea for assessment day or something you know your group's going to do that you think is cool or worth sharing, maybe write it on the back and give me a little more information because I'd love to hear that. I also ask at the bottom, I said, if you have any questions or needs, write something on the back and I will look at those and contact you. So if you're talking with your department today and you realize you don't understand something, you have a question, put it on the back and I will look at those and get back to you. So there's just a simple, these eight boxes here are just sort of different things you could do during that time to kind of give you direction as you're thinking toward that. And there's just different sort of levels, I guess, of work. Maybe you want to go back to the basics and look at your learning goals and spend a couple hours saying, why do we have eight learning goals in our program? We don't need eight. Let's get it down to five. Maybe you spend the work doing that because then you have to assess five learning goals and not eight. Maybe you want to refine your plan. Or maybe you're like, no, we got great data. We want to move this direction. We're going to be analyzing data, acting on that data. Maybe you're going to bring a sample of work. I actually offer that as a highly recommended activity. If you can, whether you're a group of one or two or five or seven or ten, looking at student work together, a sample, and then analyzing it with a rubric or checklist and just talking about it and then reporting that, what you observed and came up with, is a very valuable activity. That's, as I've done my assessment research, that comes back and back and back as one of the most valued things by faculty. If they actually come together and look at actual work and then evaluate it in some way and talk about it. I just watched a video yesterday of a videography teacher working with his colleagues, and they looked at three videos together and rated them quietly and separately, and then came together and talked about them, and they used that as their assessment, and they reported data from that as well. So just a thought. So as you come together, complete this work plan, what I'm going to do is just sit over here, maybe mosey a little bit, to see if people have questions. So either come get me or I'll come find you, raise your hand if you need something. Otherwise, we'll just spend this next 15 minutes or so giving you some time to meet with your department because we know you haven't had time to talk about assessment, so here's at least 20 minutes to touch base, think toward April 7th, find out where that assessment data is you've been gathering or not gathering and make a plan for that, make it embedded into what you do, try to keep it simple for yourselves and streamlined. Again, thank you for your time and your continued engagement and your encouragement throughout this process, and be in touch if you do need anything. Just a last thought. No, that's it. Thank you so much. Have a great day and good luck with your spring semester. Take care.
all kinds of things that we need to do in our respective departments. So if we could convene, I'd certainly appreciate it. Thank you. So my session today deals with three R's: restructuring, recruitment, and retention, where we are and what lies ahead. So first of all, though, on behalf of the entire Student Services Division, welcome to spring 2017. And I know we're hopeful that you had an opportunity to get some rest and relaxation in the midst of a holiday season and are looking forward to the coming semester with much anticipation, even though presently, how many degrees are we below zero outside right now?
Too many.
80, okay. It will only get better. And we have much to look forward to, not only in increasing better weather, but we have much to look forward to in 2017 as well. So we'll be talking about the three R's. They're not the three R's you might be thinking about, but my plan in my introductory comments today is to update you on our restructuring student services and some initiatives related to recruitment and retention. With the help of my esteemed colleagues, Nick Heiser is going to help Kendall's and Mike Barnaby as well. So I'm excited to tell you that while you were on break, we did indeed release through email the student service restructure recommendations that were approved by the executive team. Just to recap a moment, we, as you know, we were faced with a staffing reduction of four positions in student services that really required us to do significant rethinking about services and in support to students and across the entire spectrum of what we do in student services. So to begin, in terms of information services, that's one of the areas that was impacted. In terms of our customer service capacity, meaning what we will handle at the front desk and what will be handled elsewhere, one of the things I felt important to point out, especially for faculty, is that where you reserve a vehicle and who you work with in reserving a vehicle will change. Now, I believe the details are still being worked out on that, so those will be released for you when they're finalized, but that's an important consideration that, first of all, you'll need to make note of for those of you who need vehicles. Moving along, though, we'll have a new approach to recruiting, and this approach has three components to it. And frankly, to give you kind of put a picture in your head, it's much more of a decentralized approach, and it's going to involve more individuals than was the case in the past where we had one recruiter. So I'm going to talk about these in terms of components. The first component is the college recruiting component. And so what do I mean by that? The college recruiting component, and I'm going to emphasize college there, is to ensure Central Lakes is seen and recognized as an institution of choice, meaning a college that the student finds to be a good fit for them. So what does that mean? Well, it means students may be looking for a particular type of academic program. They may be looking for a particular type of student experience, such as a lot of the things that we do out of the classroom, a lot of the leadership opportunities we present and support here. And truly, they may be looking for opportunities to learn about themselves and grow as individuals, which I think we happen to excel at, among other things. I know I see so much change in students, even from semester to semester, in terms of the opportunities they have and what it means for them as a person. Now, then, other students are looking for a quality education at an affordable price. So all those things have to do with fit, and that's what college recruiting helps people understand in terms of what we can offer at CLC. So what is this decentralized approach I'm talking about? Well, it's kind of a grassroots approach. It's kind of a collaborative, it's a cooperative approach, but it does involve the help of faculty members. First of all, now, faculty members who are willing to do so and who are interested in taking on this kind of assignment and have reviewed their teaching loads and talked with their academic dean and have determined they indeed might have capacity to take on this kind of assignment. So you can see there's a lot of considerations that go into deciding to participation in this. The final step then is something called an RCE, and many of you are involved, know what RCEs are, but that's a sign-off process that verifies that the assignment about to be undertaken is agreed to by the parties concerned. Well, so far we've had limited participation, but I'm happy to report that discussions continue with faculty and how to work with interested faculty in providing RCEs of this nature. Basically, what we're asking in student services is asking for help. We're in high school visits and in our Minnesota education fairs. So while we're just getting this initiative off the ground, we anticipate that in the future, more of you will want to be involved with this in the near future and even into next year, both fall and spring semester. So just planting the seed there. There's really a benefit to this, and it not only, as I mentioned, getting a greater number of folks involved with recruiting, but one of the tremendous benefits I see is that then potential students have an opportunity to interact with actual instructors and get that viewpoint in determining goodness of fit for themselves in picking a college experience. I will tell you from experience, I know often that students don't get to talk with faculty until the first day of class. So it is a tremendous benefit, and I know it's one of the things we've worked into our registration days here, is having faculty be able to provide a perspective on what is this college experience that we're talking about. And that is an important factor in deciding. So I'm grateful Nick Heiser is going to be talking more in detail about the college recruiting aspect and some of the resources that we're going to have available to help equip faculty in this capacity. In fact, he's filling in for Jenny Brozy, who's on maternity leave. We've developed a recruiting toolkit to help faculty feel comfortable in taking on this kind of role. So that's component one. Component two. Component two is programmatic enrollment plan. Now, this approach is unique in that it supports program marketing. And you've already started this process in actuality. It is a partnership between faculty, that includes both CTE and liberal arts faculty, your academic dean, our advisors, and marketing. And so this, if you recall, this is a continuation of the process that began last year with the marketing and enrollment meetings that you participated in and where you reviewed your program data. And again, to help you recall, this approach involved organizing us into 10 cluster areas. And in many cases, your cluster helped focus on recruiting, if that where the emphasis was deemed a priority after you reviewed your data. And in others of you focused on retention, if that would emerge as a primary concern, and then what strategies you would use or want to use in moving forward. So this, in essence, is really a data-based approach, and it's really based on an analysis of your program data and trend analysis. So I know Nick has already organized his paperwork here, and he will be talking with you. Actually, he has prepared documents for each program, and in essence has captured what would be considered your benchmark data in terms of where your starting points are, and as well as the next steps that you would want to embrace as we move forward in this process. That's an exciting kind of component that helps us really monitor as we move along how are we doing in terms of attracting students to programs and moving forward in completing the goals as identified in each of the areas. So that's component number two. We've also developed a third component to put in our repertoire of recruiting responsibilities. That involves the Office of Secondary Relations, who has generously offered to expand what they do when they go to high schools and do CIS, high school visitation programs. They're going to expand that visitation within the high schools to include opportunities for students who are not involved in CIS, but would like to know more about Central Lakes College. They've expanded that component in cooperation with the counselors in order to have that happen. So Sabita Lehman, in this case, is the representative for CIS doing these high school visits, and she will be happy to work with these students in terms of talking with them about the benefits of attending CLC, how they might apply, what the next steps for them might be. The next component, I guess, has emerged more recently, and I'm pleased to say that we will be able to offer a part-time temporary 0.5 FTE recruiting position more toward the end of our recruiting year, meaning April, May, June. And the benefit of that particular personnel decision will really help us follow up on the end of the recruiting year details with getting students to move through the next step. So we can look forward to having a recruiter involved in April, May, and June to help us close out the recruiting season. This is only a temporary position, and it'll be a duration of 3 months. And again, but it will be critical to ensure that students take the next step in becoming a student at CLC. So, as you can tell, this is a new approach. We'll continue to monitor our plan's progress as we go forward. I am confident that this diversified approach, meaning the college marketing approach, the programmatic enrollment planning approach involving you, the enhanced high school visits that will include the opportunity for a CLC representative for CIS to work with non-CIS students, and that additional part-time staffing at the end of the recruitment year, April, May, June, will be an effective approach. By involving multiple folks in multiple locations and, frankly, in multiple venues, I know some of the discussions involve where indeed we would search for our potential student populations. Some of the venues that have come up include things like trade shows, for example. But the programs, I think programs know where their students tend to typically come from and how we might best capitalizing on what we know. So President Charlier has asked us to at least keep enrollment flat. I think especially with this approach, we can do better than that, because what we'll build into this process is identifying benchmarks along the way that'll help us monitor and adjust what we need to do. So, that was quick, I know, but I've been asked to keep us on time, and I do want to say, though, that there are many, many other components to the student services restructure. In fact, pages and pages of tasks and responsibilities that I won't have time to go into detail about here. What we've really focused on here are the aspects of enrollment management, what's happening in recruitment, and how that also supports retention. And I know that's a topic that's near and dear to the hearts and minds of you as faculty, as well as all of us here. But I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that components of the restructure I'm not talking about are just as critical. So as you look at the email on the student services recommendation, you'll see that there are individuals taking on large chunks of things that are important not only to the academic life of student here, but to our life as an institution. One of the large ones is the degree audit system. That's a huge system that is kind of the nerve center of all things, academic program and student record based. And so thanks to Diane Breitling for being willing to take on this particular responsibility as we move forward. Additionally, athletic eligibility is an important consideration for us. We have over 255 athletes distributed over six sports, and they have to be found to be eligible to play for them to participate, which is a rigorous process. So thank you, Mike Barnaby, for taking on that particular process. Also, our advisors are taking on expanded roles, especially in the programmatic enrollment plan process, where they're going to work with students as soon as they apply and become interested in Central Lakes College, all the way through their academic life cycle here at CLC as part of this programmatic enrollment plan that Nick will share with us in more detail about. So, enrollment services, as you well know, is a process-based operation, and it's vital for our student success as well as our success that all of our functions and processes, whether they're large or small, are designed and carried out to move the student through everything from recruitment, admissions, enrollment, advising, financial aid, and the academic life cycle. So, before we move on to the student concern process, I do want to publicly thank the members of the Student Services Division, and especially all of you who've stepped forward to ensure our restructure continues to effectively serve those we're designed to support. So, I would encourage you, if you have questions, would like to know more information, I want you to please feel free to contact me. I'd be happy to talk with you about next steps. Okay, any questions right now? Okay. Let me see if I'm on time here. Okay. The next component of our agenda concerns the student and frankly, this is an audience participation segment. This is where you, the audience, come into play, and you'll need some tools to do so. So the tools that you will need are, if you don't have one individually, please share, but you need to find the student concern poster, and you need to find the student concern form. Okay. So over the course of the past year, my office has received considerable feedback on the current student concern process, which, as you may recall, looks like this. Okay? I see some head nodding. All right. Among the issues that have been shared is that students find it confusing. And this was confirmed with discussions with Student Senate. Concerns were raised that there are various versions of this form on campus, all of which do not have the correct personnel listed as far as administration, which I think adds to the confusion on the student concern process. And with this in mind, it was proposed that we look at how we might make this process more streamlined and how it might serve students and frankly everyone more effectively. So now this is where the participation process starts. We're going to walk through a demonstration on how this will work. So please, if you would, take out the poster. The next thing I'd like you to do is write somewhere on there, draft, because it's important that folks know this is a draft. All right. What you'll see with the poster, there are shades of blue and green and red, okay? You would take a look at those. This is a poster that students would consult. And then, in the event of a concern, they would go to the website that's listed on the bottom of the page. It takes them to a landing site. And the landing site explains each of these components, the blue, the red, and the green. So as you can see, especially the red and the red components deal with discrimination, sexual harassment, and discrimination kinds of issues. The green deals with sexual violence. And the blue, the bulk of the circle, deals with more generalized students' concern. All right, so I should also mention that the blue concerns go to the Office of Vice President for Academic and Student Affairs. The red and the green go to Mary Sam's office as part of her responsibilities with 1B1 and sexual violence and discrimination issues. So, let's see what's happened. What happens in this process? Who would like to pick a concern and let's walk through what happens? Anybody? Somebody? Grading assignments. Wonderful. Grading assignments. So the student goes to the website, says, I have a concern about a grading assignment. No. All right. So the student goes to the landing page, and what the student will find, this involves taking out the student concern form. The student concern form indicates that a grading assignment, the student is expected to have consulted with their instructor first. So that's where the student will not submit this form as part of this process, but will go to the instructor. Wanted to clarify that. Yes? The student does not submit this form. The student does not, in this process, the student goes directly to the instructor, who then initiates the process.
Oh, the instructor initiates
the process. And I understand, well, yes, yes. I see some concerns on the faces here, yes. Okay.
So this is the first time faculty have seen this, and the Student Affairs Committee, so we're going to involve you in what happened. So really, you should bring this through the faculty process, having the Student Affairs Committee a chance to express faculty concerns in the faculty committee process, and then bring it through faculty association and church office.
Okay. I think with that in mind, then, we will stop right there with this process. And carry on with those suggestions as far as what the next steps should be in reviewing the student concern process. I think it is valuable, though, to see what's proposed and then to work through specifically how it works in terms of what the appropriate next steps will need to be. I know as the final point in this particular process, we will need to keep a log for the Higher Learning Commission on the student concern process. That's required as part of the accreditation process. So we will we'll certainly build that in and build in the considerations that are important based on the feedback that we receive. Certainly. That is the introduction to the student concern process. We will provide further updates as we move along. I think with that, we can move on to the next component. Yes.
About verifying that the student has
Yes, we've received feedback late yesterday that we should stop the process before the form was submitted, and that certainly will be done. I mean, the process will be taken down until it is complete. Okay?
Just so you're aware.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, I think we're ready to move on to our next component. So with that, turn it over to Mr. Heiser.
Good morning, everybody. I just really want to express, I always actually really look forward to if I get an opportunity to present at Duty Day, because I work so much with so many of you on a one-on-one basis, or so many of you over email, but it's really fun, for me at least, especially, I know not all the staff are able to join us, of course, but to be all in the same room, I just think there's such value in that, and it's just very fun for me to be reunited with so many people. We're going to be talking, a group of us are going to be talking about some things with enrollment today. And before I get any further into it, a couple things always come to my mind when I'm having to talk about enrollment is I found there's some universal truths that have to do with our current state of enrollment. Is whenever you start bringing up the E word, a pit starts to grow in some people's stomachs or a lump in some people's throats. And that's because, honestly, that today, this current reality is a very challenging time for enrollment in higher ed. We're in a situation right now with a lot of high schools are declining in enrollment in terms of their graduating classes are getting smaller. We're also getting more competition from all over the state in terms of everyone's competing for a smaller number of students. And we're also in an economic recovery. And we know that in economic recoveries, college enrollments tend to go down. And we're no different than anybody else. We're in the same boat. And I also know that from talking to so many of you, that there are so many of you, so many of us at the college are working so hard with your students and to bring students here and to keep students here. And you feel like you're putting in extra hours and going above and beyond and trying to think as creatively as possible. So what I want you to hear about from us is that this presentation shouldn't make anybody feel bad. The goal for enrollment is there isn't a silver bullet, there isn't a savior, but it is up to all of us. And the ways to help with enrollment is really for us to work together as closely as possible and to have so many things work so well for students so that they can be successful. And that's really our ticket. And I know that's what so many of us are doing. So this presentation isn't to beat anyone over the head it's really to try to think about in challenging times, how can we come together and move the needle in certain areas. And I think we have some good ideas to do so, but it's gonna take a village. I don't know if many of you know this, but we have a registration session happening upstairs right now. And every time we have registration sessions, it's a really good turnout today, there's about 30 students. It reminds me of things. And one of the things it reminds me of is that our students, each of them have a story. And I think we all know this. They all come from different backgrounds, different challenges, different things in life that are happening, and all of them are so different. But a lot of them come here and we make them feel incredibly welcome because we are a community that cares about each other and cares about students. And I think that's impressed on them so much. And so many of them are just coming down. We also have groups of people that work very hard. Our staff are working very hard coordinating the show. And we also have faculty that volunteer on their own time to meet with students in these sessions to make sure that they're set up for success. And the last thing that presses me on is that everything we do impacts enrollment. Now, that's not always a good thing. I think we do it because we want to change lives and make people's success, and we know education is the ticket to do it. But everything we do in the classroom and outside of it impacts enrollment. So I just want to encourage all of you, and I'm not starting this presentation saying, well, we got to do this, we got to change this. The key is, first of all, I think we need to acknowledge that everyone's working really hard, and to state the goal is to come together as much as we can around these subjects to help our students. Now, we have a great presentation for you today, and the first thing we wanted to start off with was talking a little bit about our FNFW last date of attendance grades, because that's a big retention issue, and we wanted to make sure we're all on the same page about how this works. And since I have a clicker, I'm just gonna try that. Oh, it works. You moved it ahead. Mike's my clicker. Woo! Okay. So we're going to go through this part first, and then we're going to get into some of our recruiting strategies, as Jane talked about. And then I promise you, so we're not talking at you long, we also have a kind of interactive, it's not a scary interactive time. We're going to have you stand up and grab some information, but we'll do that in a little bit. So the first thing we want to talk about is FN and FW grades. Okay? And what are those grades? Well, those grades, first of all, you need to know that those grades are what are assigned to students who stop attending or never attending your class. So if they never attended, they get an FN grade. If they stop attending, they are given an FW grade. Okay? If they complete the course, of course, they're given an F grade if they fail, or if they complete the course, they get an A, B, C, D grade, or you can give them an I grade, or they get NC grades in developmental. But the FN and FW is what we're really going to talk about today, because those can be the most confusing, and they have so many different tails, because they impact the students whether they're suspended or not, they impact their grade point average in different areas, and they also have financial aid impacts. Okay, so that's what these grades mean that we're talking about, and they're important, which is why we want to share with them today. I also want to state, just so we're all clear, that these grades are the grades that you as faculty assign to them, and that is within your scope to assign them. And these sorts of default grades were approved by AASC years ago, so they have been our default grades. So if someone says, well, Nick, I don't agree, I'd say, great, let's bring it through a faculty committee, and then we would bring it through AASC in terms of any sort of shared, you know, governance process if we wanted to change them. But that's currently what has been the case for a number of years. Okay? So that's the default grades that we're going to be using, that you would be delivering to students at the end of the term if they've never attended or stopped attending. So Mike's going to talk a little bit about why they're important.
Thanks, Nick. My name is Mike Barnaby. I'm the Director of Financial Aid here. These are probably two of the most confusing grades that you will deal with on a term-by-term basis, but they're very, very critical, and critical for two reasons. The first reason is the Department of Ed says we have to do something like this. They require all colleges to make sure there is a mechanism in place to make sure your students are, number one, beginning attendance. That's a gimme. We have to do that. That is where the FN grade comes in, the student who has never attended one class period. The second piece of that puzzle is the student who stops attending. That's where the FW comes in. We need your help to determine those two things so we can make sure students are receiving their financial aid correctly. And as Nick said, at the end of the term, with satisfactory academic progress and things like that. So we react to when you support those grades to report those grades to us. Okay? So the next piece of this puzzle, where it comes in with the recruitment and retention piece, is at the end of the term, we have to run grades for all the students. And if you have not reported something in a timely fashion, we have to react to that at the end of the term. As an example, and we are working through this actually right now for fall term, if you don't report a student who's never attended until the end of the term, we have to then go back and reverse financial aid on that class. Okay, let me say that again. We have to go and tell the student they now owe us $100 or $2,000 back in financial aid. That puts a bill on their account. What happens when there's a bill on their account? They can't register for the next term or a subsequent term. So that's where retention comes in with a very large factor with this. So we need your help to make sure these things are being reported in a timely basis. When do you want to report an FN grade? We want you to do that as soon as the drop-ed period is over. Students have 5 days to drop and add classes. We want you to report the students who've never attended right after that. That happens before we disperse financial aid. Okay. You can always go in and change that grade. Student walks in on the seventh day of class and says, you know, I was not able to come for one reason or another. We all hear those reasons. You can always go in and reverse that grade and get them back in your class. Then we will pay financial aid on it. Where the problem comes in is when we have paid financial aid and they've never attended, and then you tell us after we've dispersed their money. One of the most difficult parts of my team's job is to tell a student, you now owe us money back that we have given you. That's never a good thing. The business office shows that they've got over $100,000 in these types of receivables on our accounts right now. That's a lot of money. So we need your help to report things in a very, very timely basis on these two pieces.
All right. Oh,
yeah?
How much would they
question is, what is the cost to the institution with this? Well, as I stated, I believe Chris Anderson gave some numbers last year where it's over $100,000. Yes, way in the back.
If we have a class that meets one day a week, that first week, if the student isn't there, should we put that in on the
sixth day? I would give them two chances.
Two chances? Okay.
That's what I would say.
Okay.
Once again, you can always go in and reverse that. Very good questions. And please, please continue to ask questions. That's a great segue, Gordy, to the next piece of this puzzle. Thank you. Okay, I think we put an example up here. You want to talk about it, Nick?
Scary student, Nicholas Barnaby. I don't know what that person would look like. He did say good looking. This is the student's first semester at the CLC courses, okay? So this individual started with English, geography, math, and another unnamed class, because we didn't want to ever call it a department. And you can see here, things didn't work out. Some things outside of their control, life happened. And you can see here, they stopped attending an English course pretty quickly on 9-2. And so the faculty awarded them an FW grade, and we are going to get to Gordy's question. Then they took a geography course, and again, right about the same time, and this is generally a report that we see commonly when we're running grade reports. And then you see a third class, again, around the same time they're marked. Now, one thing you see is that they're not all on the same date, and that's sometimes because classes meet at different times or students stuck it out, you know, but those are approximate dates. You have a pretty good idea that they kind of stopped attending most midway through September. But then there was one course where they were marked as completed the term. And we look at them and say, huh, that looks pretty interesting because they'd stopped attending the three out of the four. Why did they keep going to the four? Is that correct? And sometimes we've even emailed you and said, hey, this looks a little funny. Is this correct? Well, what happens, Mike, do you want to talk a little bit about what happens with that student's financial aid if they would have got a full Pell Grant and maybe they even took out some loans with that class not being marked as an F until the end of the term?
What happens with this, and we're actually working with over 40 students right now with this exact same scenario. So this raises questions within our department, and one thing we don't like to play is God in our area. We're guessing what this is. And so we're contacting students and or faculty to find out, did you complete the term? As Nick said, in this case scenario, when they get an F grade, that means they earned the F. They completed the term. They went through everything. Okay, they completed everything all the way through the final. If they stopped attending, Gordy, in your case, they stopped attending 2 weeks prior to the final, they can still would get an FW grade with the last date of attendance 2 weeks prior to the end of the term, whenever their last date of attendance was. An F to us and to the end of the computer system means they completed the whole term and earned an F grade. Does that make sense to people? Okay. Yes. Well, that's going to get into actually one of our next slides, the whole policy. Basically, this is Central Lakes College's policy. This is formed through the U.S. Department of Education, through the state of Minnesota, through Minnesota State University and Colleges, and then CLC. Basically, this explains everything regarding last date of attendance, not or the FN grade, never attended. It also talks about when you should report your grades. There's a line in here, under stopped attending, it says 14 calendar days. So if you don't see a student in class for 14 days, that is when you're supposed to be reporting. This is in CLC policy.
One thing, we had lots of discussions on this one at ASC, and I want to be clear though, you as faculty members are the final arbiter of the grade, okay? So you can see up here it says, unless otherwise notated by the faculty or course syllabus, okay? So what I think, what I want you to hear is this is giving you some tools and some commons practices, but this does not supersede your freedom and your ability to grade, okay? So we've had issues too where a student was cheating and they said, well, I think the student should earn an F. They should earn an FW grade because an FW grade doesn't count like an F. An F means you failed. FW means it's an unofficial withdrawal. It doesn't hurt your GPA. The same is true of an FN. I think the student, in my faculty, in my opinion, as the arbiter of the grade, should receive an F grade. You have that right to do that, okay? We may send you an email and say, hey, this looks a little funky. Is this correct? Just to make sure everything's right, because sometimes people make mistakes. But that is still your right as a faculty. So I want to be clear on that. This is a guiding principle. So for those of you that say, Nick and Mike, just tell me what to do and I'll do it. There you go. But for those of you who say, you know what? I do it this way and this is my policy. You have that freedom to do so.
Yes, Terry.
The combination fixed that you had up there?
Yeah, let's go back to that. Okay, did everyone hear the question? What happens if that last grade, that F grade, was an actual FW? We in the financial aid office, every 2 weeks, correct, Crystal? Every 2 weeks, we run reports to find out what students have totally withdrawn or unofficially withdrawn, in other words, an FW grade, from all of their classes. That's what hits in our department when they are totally gone. If they have one class that's still out there, like in this case, we don't have to do anything in our department, okay? We do not have to do, there's a process called return to Title IV funds. And basically that says we are required to make sure they are attending through 60% of the term, okay? So in this student's case, we did not return financial aid on their behalf. Did we do it right? That's up to that last faculty there. Okay, we get audited on this stuff. This is one of the largest audit findings in the country, is this process right here. And please, I do not want to have to take the auditor who's in my office saying, I want to see that F grade. I want to see the enrollment book, or I want to see, not the enrollment book, the grading book for that student. Please take me to that faculty person. Because I will walk them to your office, say they want to look at it. They have the right to do that. Gordy, go ahead.
Well, my understanding that if a student is taking 16 credits and they stop attending all but one 3-credit class, they still retain all of their financial aid. They don't have to pay back if they quit.
That is correct. That is correct. It is a total withdrawal that we're dealing with. Believe me, it's a lot better than it used to be. Right, Sandra? Yes, Mark.
I get comprehensive final exam. That can replace exams that either they did poorly on or they didn't take at all. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I look at that and there's students that they really, I guess, do quit attending at the very end of the semester. But until the final is given, I can't figure out a grade. Where they were, what they were doing, you know, somehow.
I have a question. So here's the case, you have a student who showed up for the whole semester and didn't show up for the final. Then you tried to reach out to them, you sent them an email, they wouldn't respond, but then you have to enter your grades for the due date. What do you do then? Can you give the student an FW or F?
Yes. Yeah.
It's your
yes.
Fault.
Yes. Conversation. Thank you. Anything else? Yes, Paul.
So I have a class that goes the first half of the semester and then another class starts. Could their financial aid be set up so they don't get it all right at the beginning of the semester?
Paul's question was when you have a two-section term and they take a core bunch of classes, the first half of the term, another course, whole different set of courses, the second half of the term, can we set up financial aid to only pay out half at the beginning and half at the end? No, we cannot. There's different federal regulations that would attach to that would get very, very complex on a student by student basis. Number one, our system isn't set up to do that. Number two, we don't have the staff size to do that either. So. And please don't misconstrue this that we want you to go in and take attendance on a daily basis. We are not asking that. That also would throw us into a whole other realm of federal regulations that would take probably four times as much work as this is already asking you to do. So taking attendance is your decision if you want to take attendance or not. But you do need to show at some point in time when a student did stop attending. Yes? How many take attendance? Okay, quite a few. Okay. No. Well, let me ask the group. Question here is, are we required to take attendance? The question is, how do you know when they've stopped attending? Do you have a grade book? There you go. Last assignment. The question is, what does financial aid cover, basically? I take it all very seriously. I've been doing this for 32 years. That's why I lost all my hair. Either that or a hockey helmet. I can't figure out which. Basically, what financial aid covers first is their bill here. Okay, everything has to attach to their bill that they have here at the college. That's number one. If there is more financial aid than what their bill covers, they have the ability to charge in the bookstore, to use that money to charge there, and then they can use that money for transportation costs or room and board, things like that. That is federal regulation. Okay. Pardon? The question... They received additional funding after their tuition and fees were covered. Okay, and then we can run a calculation based on their last date of attendance to say how much did they not earn of that financial aid. Yes, we do. It's a big deal. Yes. The question revolves or came about with our satisfactory academic progress policy. If a student continues to do this example term after term, they will get placed on the first term. If they have this grades after their first term here in the fall, they'll get placed on academic and financial aid warning. If they do this two terms in a row, then they get placed on suspension. They can't re-enroll for classes and receive financial aid until they appeal to come back. How many students do we have on our list this year, Nick, from fall?
Yeah, we have about 250 suspended, 300 warned, and 100 probation or so. Every year it's about 1,000 to 1,200 students that are impacted some part of this process. 6,000. But a lot of them are repeaters too, because you were warned and then you were suspended. But that's the side of it's probably like 20
employees. This is nationwide. This is a big deal. And if anyone has coworkers or friends who worked at St. Cloud State about 7 years ago, they got hit with over $1 million fine because of this. What would happen here if we get hit with $1 million fine? Jane, what would happen? Okay. There's a lot of questions going on. I'm not sure where we're at with time. Okay, that's fine. Okay, I'm going to start at this end and work my way around.
Nick mentioned warned and probation. Warned is your first semester if you don't meet our minimum standards, 2.0 and a 67% completion rate. You're warned. If you got to get those above those standards by your next semester, you're going to be suspended. Probation, so then let's say they're suspended and they appeal to come back and they say, well, you understand this happened. I think I'm ready to go. We think they are ready to go back. We say yes.
Suspension, and if they appeal to come back, then they get placed on probation. Okay. Jody.
I have a question about PSEOs for the F grade and the FN grade, or FW grade. So because they don't get financial aid, does it still apply to them also? So if they stopped 2 weeks before the end of the semester, they would get the FW? And so if so, it's not really all about financial aid. Correct.
We have one policy here. It does not matter if you're on financial aid or not. And that can be a great debate. Should we break out the financial aid students from not the financial aid students?
So then when they come back as a regular student, their transcript remains the same for them.
Correct. Okay, work across.
My question, you said the FN and the FW don't affect your GPA?
Correct.
So when I have students who in nursing you need a B to progress,
lower one goes away.
Not off their transcript, it doesn't count towards their GPA. Once it grades on the transcript,
it's
stuck.
On their transcript.
Unless
so later on, when they want to go on for their master's and their bachelor's, it will count on their total transcript grade. But the FW doesn't?
If you, no. If you do a repeat, the C grade stays on the transcript. When you repeat it, you get a B. We only count the B on the GPA calculation.
Okay.
C stuck on the transcript. If I was a student, I'd rather have a grade that's
okay, Mark?
I got my question, so I'm going to make it cool. On suspension, since it's federally effective at any institution in Minnesota, U.S., or only here?
Well, everybody in the country has this the basic same satisfactory academic progress policy. Okay, because the standards are the same. It is Min State wide.
But if they went online to Montana State.
They went to the University of Minnesota, Duluth.
We're supposed to be monitoring and supporting each other's suspension. Are there loopholes? Yes. If someone comes to CLC and they're on suspension actively from somewhere else and we see it, we make them appeal to come back. Does everyone do that with loopholes? Yes. It's not everyone knows. I'm just going to share that.
Okay, I think there was one more question over here.
Last one.
If you take attendance every day, and that's a portion of your grade, and the person comes intermittently, and they have basically failed because of attendance alone, so then they get stopped, how many does that account for them? So they've already earned the effort.
Well, it's really your choice which way you'd want to do it. How I look at it, and this is just my own little opinion, is if they complete the term, they would get an F grade. If they stopped any time prior to the end of the term, they would get an FW grade. I mean, it keeps it simple that way. Okay, I don't see any hands raised. Oh, I do! Kari!
I'm bending the rules, I know, I'm sorry. But in that respect, what is, I know there's like a federal, like when is our last day to withdraw? Isn't that so many days before the end of the semester? And that doesn't come into play then with
It's a 75% point of the term, so whatever the 75% point of the course is, that's the last day of the class in all of your courses. That
right.
So you as a faculty member could say, you know what, I'm going to give FW grades up to the 75%
right.
term, and then I'm going to give F grades. Now, we still would ask, you still can put with an F grade the last day of attendance, when that was. It's a crucial thing we really need is that last day of attendance. The same thing with some of the sheets. They could get an F grade on September 1st, but we'd like to know what that last day of attendance is if they cheated and got kicked out of class on September 1st instead of September, December 16th. So you can do that if you decide to do that as a faculty member. And that came up when we were talking about this whole thing with FS and FW when we actually put it in policy. That is it's a little vague.
Okay, thank you. Have a great term.
It's funny, Mike and I were talking about this and we're like, oh, this will be 5 minutes, then we'll launch into enrollment. Yeah, right. So we have about half an hour, so we're going to streamline this, but we're going to keep it moving here. And I think before, as we transition, I think the first thing we should do is we're going to have a little piece where we're going to have you review some data. So what I'd like you to do is we have you all arranged. All of us, we've decided as a college, fit into 10 different career clusters, or it might be 11, counting liberal arts AA. So what I'd like to do is, depending on what discipline you teach, if you could all come up to the front, stretch your legs, and we have little signs by these tables that talk about your discipline by what cluster you're in, and then if you could grab a sheet, a packet, behind that sheet and then have a seat again. We're going to be reviewing some data based upon your area. So if you could take the next 2 minutes and just do that, grab the stuff, organize chaos, and then have a seat back down, that would be great. And we're going to talk about enrollment. I know I just gave you a quick break, but grab the paperwork you need and have a seat. Okay. Leave all these extroverts. So we're gonna churn here, and we're gonna talk from retention activities to recruitment activities. And as Jane said, we're going ahead with a model in which we're going to really break down our recruiting efforts into two distinct areas. One is general college recruitment, and the other one is programmatic recruitment. And the goal for today is to tell you about each of them and talk about what the next steps are and have to give you some insight into what's happening in your areas, okay? So the first thing we need to talk about with general college recruiting is just what is it? There are times when CLC is asked to be at events to showcase the entire college. There are also times in our time where we're recruiting where our recruiter, when we had a recruiter, was being asked to talk about a specific program or a specific area. Or we do things like camps. I know there's a meeting on the NitroX camp, which is a phenomenal recruiting tool for some of our manufacturing and transportation career and technical fields. So that's more programmatic areas. But then there's areas where just people want to know about the general college, like we have career fairs, or we're going to do high school visits in certain areas, and we want to talk about all the programs we offer at CLC. So we're defining that as general college recruitment. So the question now is, okay, so without a recruiter, there's going to be these things throughout the year. That's how are we going to cover these sorts of events when the general college side? Well, what we're basically going to do is we're going to transition from having one person do it to having an army or a team of people doing it, okay? So we're going to have various individuals on behalf of the college going out to do that. Well, there's some challenges, of course. The advantages of that model is we're going to get some different faces and perspectives of representing CLC. The challenges, of course, is how are we going to get all these faces and people to be well-versed in what we offer and what's good about the college. So we have to think about how to set them up for success and how to give them the training and the tools they need and define the scope so they have a mission they feel like they can achieve as well. So what we're going to do then is we've created some tools for them, which we're going to outline here in a little bit. But basically, what's going to happen with this is that we are going to send these people out with a toolbox of materials, and we're going to give them some training. And they're basically going to be able to talk about the programs that we offer, some of the talking selling points of Central Lakes College, and some of the advantages to coming here. And their job is to get from students one of two things, an interest card or an application. Okay? Interest card or application is their mission. That's their scope. From that point, what we're going to do is having them complete a form where they're going to indicate whether their mission was successful at certain areas. So we're gonna, because we have less resources in recruiting, we have to use those resources even smarter. So we're gonna track to make sure it's successful. And I'm gonna show you how it's gonna look right here, as long as the computer operates correctly. So the first step in the process is the individual doing the general college recruiting is going to be Mark. People said to tone it down.
You don't have to tone it down.
So I'm just very passionate. So with recruiting, I gotta retrain myself here. The individual that's gonna go out is going to talk to the high schools and find a time that they're gonna go or go to a certain event. And when they do that, they're going to let our admissions office know, and our admissions office is going to put it on our visit calendar. And let me show you this, because you're going to be able to see where we're going and what we're doing anytime, because it's going to be on the web. So I'm going to show you where it is right here. Okay, so this is our outreach page. Now, as Jane said, we're just getting things going with our general college recruitment. So over time, you're going to see these things populate with dates. But this is going to be where you're going to be able to go to see where we're going and what we're doing on the general college recruitment side, and later on the programmatic recruitment side, which I'm going to get to. But the key thing here is that we all transparently now can see what we're doing with recruiting and where we're going. Okay, so it doesn't need to be a mystery anymore about what we're doing. We can see this back through our history, because I can take it back. And you can see here what we were doing in November. Okay, you can keep going back all the way to the beginning, not really the beginning of time, but the beginning of when we started using this tool. Okay, after the recruiting session is over, this person doing the recruitment is going to fill out a report. Let me show you what it looks like. It's going to be on SharePoint. Some of you are probably thinking, oh, not SharePoint, never SharePoint. And this is what it looks like. It's fairly fast to fill out, but we basically want to know who went, what you did, was it effective? Because what we're going to do at the end of the year then is look at certain regions and figure out how we're getting in terms of access and what things are working and what aren't. So we're actually going to be able to know what's effective with our recruitment in terms of using data. So I think that's a very good step in the right direction. So we're able to publicly see and compile these reports really quickly. Okay, so that's part one. Part two is programmatic recruitment. So what is that? Well, as I said before, we have areas where we as a college know that we can support different aspects of our programs, and those are what those programs need. Some programs need more help on their recruitment side. Some programs are doing great on the recruitment side, but it is a challenge to keep students. So we gotta think about, you know, ways we can support these students or bring them in with better expectations of what they're going to be getting into, or do more proactive things. Other programs have different issues in terms of maybe it's marketing viability. And so when we think about ourselves as a college, oftentimes, you know, we look at that general enrollment number. But that general enrollment number doesn't really do us a lot of good, because oftentimes you might look at that and say, well, yeah, but okay, that's like 3,000 FYE, that's 6,000 students. That's so big. But the key point here with enrollment is we are a collection of programs. Just like our students are a collection from programs with different stories, every one of our programs has different stories as well. And if you figure out ways to individually help the programs, the entire college is going to grow, right? Because if all the programs are growing, we're all growing as a college. And because every program has different needs and different ideas and is interested in different things, we're going to create, we're going to have a general college plan that I just talked about, but we're also going to be talking about how can we best increase enrollment as your program. For your program. And that's really where we're going to, those sheets are going to come in. So how are we going to do this? Well, we have made the first distinction, and we are changing the way our advisors are doing business. And we're going to have them work closer with programs in the extent that the advisor that's attached to a specific program is going to be really that enrollment manager for your program. And the listing of our advisors and what programs they're attached to and what their responsibilities are on the back page of that handout that you got in terms of all of the different roles. And I also put on there all the different responsibilities, because student services has changed so much, to show you know kind of who does what. So it also has some other individuals on the registration side as well. But it really is focused on admissions and advising. So that's the first thing you need to know, is that's how we're going to be changing gears. So instead of having potentially one recruiter for the college, your program is going to have one enrollment manager that's going to be working closely with your program to help support students in that program. So we're trying to make that connection even stronger. Okay, so that's really what's programmatic enrollment. So how are we going to do this, and what are the goals? Well, the way we're going to roll this out is very similar to what we did last year with a few tweaks. So what we did last year, and I think we had a very good start, where Ken and I and some others met with programs with the administrators, the deans, by cluster area. And together we came up with some really good ideas of some things we could do to move the needle. What we're going to do this year now is we're going to continue that, but the advisor is going to be a key player in these meetings. These meetings will be facilitated by myself and Ken. The dean of your areas is going to organize you. It's sometime between now and March. I'm going to invite you to a conversation that works for you and your teaching load. And we're going to get together and talk about what can we do to move the needle. And as I said before, what we're going to really focus on are looking at your program. Your program may have different needs than other programs. So we should really focus on what your program needs to support students in your program. And other programs should work on really what their needs are and what their challenges are. And I think, Ken, maybe now would be a good time to talk through how marketing will fit into these conversations. Do you want to take it from here?
Thank you, Nick. Hello, I'm Ken, the marketing guy. I was up here at least an hour last year with a whole bunch of slides, so I'm not going to take your time with slides today. So I just got three things I want to cover. First thing is, as Nick mentioned, I really want to emphasize that these cluster meetings that we're going to have, and I believe we're going to try to work with the deans to schedule these in January and February, so we're going to try to get these things bumped up as soon into the spring semester as possible, so we can get these in and actually get your ideas and thoughts put into play as soon as possible. And with that, I've put out a survey for faculty to fill out. And you've done a really great job filling that out so far. I would say we have about half of the faculty have filled that out. So if the other half would consider that, I just put an email out today. And no matter if you're in a technical program or you're liberal arts, it's a very open-ended survey. So you can put anything into those boxes. I'm not suppressing them down to 140 characters or anything like Twitter. So you can put as much information or as little information. If there's questions that you don't want to answer, that's fine. Fill out as much or little of that as you'd like. But what I really want to use that for is to go through that information by your clusters and have that ready to go. Because we know that everybody's time is super limited and valuable. So when we get to these cluster meetings, we may only have about an hour, hour and a half to take care of a lot of business. And as Nick said, I mean, we want to get this really down to a programmatic level. We've instituted some good things from a programmatic advertising that we've been doing since the last time we met, but we really want to take it another step further and get the word out about your program. So please, if you can, today I've opened it up again, that survey. I have it open up through, I believe, next Friday. So please jump on that survey, then we can take that information, bring it to the cluster meetings, and really get some value and kind of be one step ahead of the game at that point. The other things that I'm going to mention is I'm sorry that I'm taking up the valuable time. And I want to thank my colleagues, Jane and Nick, for inviting me to be part of the show today. And I really want to put out a public thank you that they've been doing a great job trying to put together some tough pieces in their areas. And I really want to commend them publicly for that. So, okay. Just two kind of then house cleaning things. I want to say thank you to everybody for being part of the people that have been part of the Defining CLC Experience meetings I've had. I had a couple sessions yesterday and we had some lively conversation. We had a couple sessions back in December at both campuses, Staples and Brainerd. We've got a lot of good information. You can keep that information coming. We're going to be taking that information and trying to really distill that down to some good messages, and that's overall more of a broad way to sell the college and how we want to be branded and how we want to present ourselves, but it's very good information. And keep the information coming, and thank you for participating. The other thing is, as Nick mentioned about sharing the stories, your program stories, I want to emphasize with social media, you may have seen my emails that came out that Jesse had a baby on Christmas Day, and that was about 2.5 weeks in front of her schedule. She was due on January 11th, which is next week. So it did catch us as a surprise, but we're fortunate to have Aubrey filling in, and she knows the college, and she's able to jump in, and she's been jumping in already. So I really want to emphasize that we've built up, and Jesse has done a wonderful job building up a really good social media structure. We're using Facebook, we're using Twitter, we're using Snapchat, we're using Instagram and more. And our Facebook is really continues to grow like wildfire. So if you've been participating, please send us the stories. We can get out a lot more content if we don't have to necessarily track it down. We can get it out everything you send us, so please send us your stories, because it's so important to get those stories out to the public, and social media is just a fantastic way to do that. So please help us and share your stories, no matter if you think they're large or small, just get them to Aubrey or myself and we'll get them out there. Thank you very much.
So as Ken said, we're going to be having a meeting. Your deans are going to organize. Ken will be there. I'll be there. Your program advisor will be there. You'll be there. And the goal is for us to come together and think about looking at the data for our program and looking at what we can think we can do best to move the needle. What are the outcomes for these meetings? Well, the outcomes, here's where I think the beauty of it is. Oftentimes we feel like outcomes are either driven top-down or they're unsustainable, they're not going to be made. What we're really looking for are actionable things that we really think we can do, given the resources we have, that can move the needle. And we're going to record that, and we're going to hold each other accountable to make sure we get those things done. And hopefully those are going to be based upon what we think our needs of our program are, which is based upon data. So what I wanted to do today is to show you the end goal, the end product of what we're going to be looking at, so we have some time. And I also want to give you an overview of what some of this stuff means. So hopefully at these meetings, of course we're going to go through this again, but we'll have something to kind of stick to it. So when you got a programmatic enrollment plan, you can see here we kind of have a template that we're going to be looking at and recording every year. This is going to be an ongoing cycle system that we're going to put together. So here we have here a listing of who the what the year is, who the advisor of the program is, who the academic dean is, and the departments enrolled in this cluster plan. We're going to talk about the date of the meeting, who was at the meeting, and then here's really where I want to get into. I want you to start looking at the data on your programs, okay? Now, it looks like I should have made more AA degree liberal arts. I apologize. I'll have to get some more out to you. But for all of you, you should see basically four different columns, and I want to go through what they mean, because everyone's columns have different data points. The nice thing is, because of some of the enhancements we've done with data, this is very easily able to be obtained by almost all of us in this room. Now, we may not all know how to get to it, but this data is readily available, so it's easy to track. Okay? So here's one thing we could look at. We could look at what our inquiries are. Does anyone know what an inquiry is? I'm just curious. Who knows what an inquiry is? Maybe shout it out, what you think it is. Is it the initial contact? It's the initial contact with CLC. It's also a really quantifiable way to know if it's an inquiry is if they turn in an interest card saying, I want to know more about CLC. Okay? That's what that means. Okay? So what's an applications receipt? Well, that's pretty clear cut, right? That's when they turn in an application saying, I'm interested in this program at CLC. Okay? Does anyone know what a conversion rate is? What's conversion rate is? I hear some people mumbling.
How many of those departments have actually been converted to people that have not all of us submitted applications?
Well, there's actually two types of conversion rates. There's prospect to application or application to registered. And what we care most about here is, of course, applications to registered, which I'll get to a little bit. So conversion rate means how much applications did we receive versus how many people registered. Okay? And again, different programs have different stories here. And then, of course, FYE, we know what that is, right? That's, of course, the number of students registered credits divided by 30. It's a good baseline of how packed, how many full-time learners are in the program. Of course, FYE is what pays the bills. Okay? Now, a lot of colleges have what's called a funnel. And the presupposition here is that you have lots of students interested, and as they go through the enrollment process, for whatever reason, they change their mind, they can't meet the standards for the program, the number of students interested is always bigger than the number of students registered. So there's a large number of students that are interested, that are prospects, less students who are interested that actually turn and end up applying, and even less students that end up registering. Well, our college is a little different. Because you might be looking at your sheet and saying, gosh, I do not see a lot of prospects. That red flag, that's concerning, what's going on? Well, you know, that's obviously parts of our recruitment process. That's a challenge for our recruitment where we're at. But one of the reasons we have that is that a couple years ago we saw that and we said, well, you know what? Since we lose so many people between prospect and application, what if we made it easier for students to apply? What did we do? We waived the application fee. So there's no application fee. So what happens right now is a lot of students, instead of turning in an interest card, say, well, there's no risk to applying. Let me apply right now because we want to get them in the door. And so we get more applications than we do inquiries anymore. You might be wondering about that looking at the data. So what you're going to do here is you're going to be with everyone else, with this team, looking at your data, saying, oh, okay, this is where we're at right now, making some plans based upon what you think is most important to improve enrollment in our programs here. And then we're going to make sure they're reasonable. We're going to make, you know, next steps. And then we're going to go out and execute the plan. Then the hope is next year, not the hope, we will next year come back together, look at, okay, how did we do? Do we move the needle here? Yes. Here's why. No. Why not? What do we do next? And we keep this process of working together and staying engaged together to take care of our students and support them. So that is the plan with programmatic recruitment. Any questions? So a question, good question. Do we do the certificate programs, or is the we should be adding those in there? And so I bet you're getting at some of the liberal arts programs. Yes, we will put them in. Yeah, and that will, and it could be that that's a tactic that we use to sell some of the programs. So that could be a strategy of is more support of that. And also, the hard part in some of the data points is because the certificate programs, a lot of them, I think you're talking about, are liberal arts. We don't have applications. The data isn't as clear cut because they're composed of liberal arts classes. So it's a little harder on the data, but there are some pieces that we can pull from. Okay. Well, I'm gonna give you a quick presentation then on some of the tools we're gonna give our general college recruiters and just the recruitment process. Because the recruitment process is kind of one of those pieces that it's kind of, we kind of know what happens, we kind of don't. And I wanted to spell it out a little bit about whether it's programmatic recruiting we're going to be doing or general college. Wanted to give you a taste a little bit about what's going to happen. So this is a presentation actually Jenny was going to give, and I have 5 minutes to give. And so I'm going to, you know, I'm not probably not going to do it justice. But this is something that I've kind of adapted when we learned that she had a baby. So here we go from here. So the first question I guess I'd ask this group is, because I think this is a really key distinction when we're thinking about recruiting the CLC. Because sometimes people equate it with selling. And I guess I would ask, does anyone think there's a difference between recruitment and selling? I'll give you a hint. I think there is. Anyone have an idea as to what I'm getting at when I say, what's the difference between recruitment and selling? And we can't tell people to sell something they don't believe in. But we can tell people to improve for something they believe in. And that's what I think we're going to be engaging people to do. And I think that has to be the message we think about it. So I want to make the distinction, and that's what we're telling people about who we are. Okay? So here's what happens. They schedule a high school visit or a community event. They talk to their high school contacts. We have all this information now publicly available because we're going to have an army of people recruiting. And we're going to be posting it on that admissions calendar I showed you. We're going to be having a poster and sign-up sheet to the school to have students sign up if they're interested. And we're also going to call the day prior people that are signed up. And we also have listings of students from the schools that have said, yeah, I'm interested in CLC, that are a prospect, because we're going to ask to meet with them to help them apply. So that's what we're going to do before the recruiting visit for the individuals that are going out recruiting. So what individuals are going to bring with them are interest cards, pens, tablecloths, applications, materials, and we have a whole kit for them to bring. We already have all this information in the system about who at the school or at the community is interested in certain programs, so we can engage with those people. And then we also have another type of recruiting we have, our Minnesota Educational Fairs. So these are fairs where high schools, instead of going to a school, all the high schools bus their students to a certain event. We host one usually in early September for our region here. And lots of different colleges attend these. So it's kind of a big fair. And so we have a very snazzy booth with technology, and we have flyers. And the job there is to engage people and try to get them to fill in an application or an interest card, and we follow up with them after they do that. So again, the recruiter's job is really to gauge interest and get them to go through the next step, whether that's an app or an interest card. We also do high school presentations where we ask the counselor, you know, instead of waiting to have a student come see me or calling these students, could we go into a classroom and talk about the value of a college education and what CLC offers? Oftentimes there's career classes, or you as faculty might have an in with a certain faculty at a school, and so we go and we talk about those programs and how they can come to CLC on that. So we oftentimes ask. We ask for as deep of a connection to students as we possibly can get. And it's up to the schools sometimes to help us to do that. And that's really why our connection with CIS is so important, because it gives us that clear partnership. After that's done, the individual recruiting again completes that report, and they turn in any applications or interest cards to the admissions mailbox, which is in the mailroom. They complete that outcome form about whether it's successful, and then our staff, and I already kind of talked about that recruiting report, and then what happens is we then are logging those interest cards into our admissions database, and that goes to the advisor of the program to call and to see if we can get them to do the next step, which would be application or apply. And then we send out information, so, you know, if they said they wanted more information on our welding program or diesel program, we send that out to the students with packets of information from marketing. And then we contact the students to try to get them to come in and meet with us or get a tour or register for classes and start for the next semester. And then what we do is the enrollment council, which is something that Jane is leading, that group of people is going to be reviewing that enrollment data over time. So that's kind of our entire recruitment cycle in 5 minutes. I know I didn't do it justice, but that's kind of what we go into when we talk about recruiting. The key aspect for recruitment is relationship, whether that's with students or it's with the high schools, the counselors, the professionals, the teachers. Those connection points allow us to have greater access to students, to tell them about who we are, and also for the individuals that influence the students. It's just as important to have relationships with students as it is counselors and faculty members that say, you know what, I heard that CLC has an honors program. Or, you know what, I don't think you're giving career and technical education enough of enough credit here for the number of good-paying jobs and careers that you could get immediately after graduating. You really need to reconsider this. And that's really our job, to try to get new students, is to either influence the students and tell them about the great place we have here, or influence the influencers who influence the students. And that's what we have our task cut out for us. And that's really why enrollment, as much as you can have it in one person's title or anything else, it really is a team sport, because we all matter and we all play into it. So that's our spiel. Does anyone have any questions or comments about what's next? Great question. Yes. In fact, one thing you'll see in those guides is we're reorganizing that. Teresa Harsha is going to be in charge of that, and that might be a great strategy for some of our programmatic enrollment meetings, of thinking about mentors or other students who could be engaged in that. So we're going to try to actually double down on ambassadors, because we have obviously less staff in terms of in student services to do some of this recruitment work. So yes, great question. Okay. Okay, well, again, I want to thank you for your support. And looks like Jane, did you want to?
One quick comment.
Okay.
I think the message overall that we wanted to give to you this morning is that we believe we're all in this together. And as we move forward, we're very interested in especially the concerns that you bring forward. I was really pleased with the dialogue about the grading process, because if students can't progress in their academic programs, then they run the risk of dropping out. So thank you for the good dialogue. I just really want to assure you, we appreciate your support. We appreciate your comments. We're finding our way as we go. Our goal today was to help share with you what the plan that we put together is and how we're going to go about accomplishing it. So thank you for your attention. Again, I believe should be getting ready for the next segment. Is that correct, Paul? I believe so. So with that, have a good afternoon. Thank you.